13 weeks back to commemorate the silver jubilee of organic terrace gardening movement started by our late president Dr. Vishwanath. So it was very passionate for the food crops in containers, food crops in cities. And so he started slowly in 1995, and we are in the silver jubilee year. So unfortunately he is not with us, but so he is always with us. So that way that we always remember, we always believe that he is with us, and whatever we are doing, that he is probably observing and seeing and probably blessing us all the time. Today's topic is insect pests in urban foodscapes. It was supposed to be handled by one of my junior friends, Dr. G.K. Ramegowda, but somehow, unfortunately, he had to miss out in the last moment because his father is admitted to hospital. So for that purpose, he had to cancel the program. And of course, for me, I am an entomologist, and so I have handled this session at least 100 times, more than 100 times in many, many workshops, many sessions. So let me just try to take you all through the various aspects of insect pests in urban foodscapes, urban foodscapes. So to start with, let us try to understand that red word, pests. So it is always that we as probably as agriculture scientists, for me as an agriculture entomologist, the most common question in all our sessions and workshops is about pests. See, if you analyze more than 75% of the questions in Krishimela, 75% questions in many of the maybe agriculture university or any other exhibitions, whenever we conduct gardening sessions, it is all about the insect pests. So they are there. See, basically, I being an entomologist, we love insects, and we always try to probably tell people that all insects are not pests. So that way, so you need to probably understand that what are pests. So then how can we look at their damage, whether they are serious, because all these are perceptions. See, if someone says that they are all eating my leaves, probably they may not be, they may be okay with it. And someone may be probably trying to remove them, trying to kill them. So that way, so it is always there. So pests by definition, anything unwanted. We always say the pests are anything unwanted. So maybe insects, non-insects, maybe like the rats, bandicoots, or anything, maybe monkeys, or sometimes the disease-causing pathogens, plant pathogens, the weeds. So they are all pests, because we always relate this to the human. See, when we define this, it is a human-centric approach. See, for something that it is not liked by us, and we call it as pests. So we are also pests. See, if it is insect-centric, humans are pests. So we are probably eating their food. So that way, so anyway, human being on the top of the pyramid or the food pyramid, we always look at in our angle, and we try to define pests in that way. So there are different types, but today, at least, I will not be touching on plant pathogens. I will not be touching on the non-insects. So I will be touching just on insect pests. So other topics that will be, because it is a very, very vast topic. See, whatever we learn in agriculture university in 4 courses, that we have to consolidate in 60 minutes time. So that's a huge task. But based on my experience in urban foodscapes in the last 15 years, so I will just try to showcase so that we will have some basic idea of insect pests in urban foodscapes. So any injury or damage directly to him or her, when it is human centric, we call sometimes even honeybees as pests. Should we call honeybees as pests? So that is again a debatable issue. See, ants as pests is a debatable issue. So that way, so we call whether it is humans, his farm animals, his crops, his assets, sometimes maybe termites. We try to call it as call them as pests, because when they damage our furnitures, when they damage our maybe wooden wall and wooden doors and other things, or the wooden windows, so we try to call them as pests. But just imagine the same termites, the action of termites in forests, in converting the plant materials or the animal materials to soil, convert this into carbon, recycle them into soil. So then they are the most required insects in woods. So that way, so it all depends that how we look at it. At least urbanites, more privileged people, I always say in all sessions, at least I use this word, we are more privileged. So we have that ability to decide that whether they are pests, whether they are not pests. So that way, I am today's the session is on that aspect. Insects are the wonderful creatures on this world or on this earth. So very colorful, and you cannot just see, divert your attention from an insect if it is so that type. At the same time, of course, you feel bad when it comes to cockroaches. You feel bad when it comes to mosquito, when it comes to maybe house flies. But they have all the very, very significant role in nature. See, we think like that. So cockroaches, Dr. Vishwanath always used to tell, the one of the cleanest insects in the world is cockroach. But we always go with a broom stick or maybe a chapel or a Hawaii to kill them whenever we see them. So they have their own significant role in our ecosystem, our environment. So that way, you look at it today, if you maybe about 5 million types of insects that people say it is estimated that they are defined. But about 10 million insects are there. Some of them are extinct before probably coming to our maybe our textbooks, our monographs. We have not seen them, maybe very thick forests. We have not even reached them. So that kind of insects are still there. About 10 million insects are there. Of that 10 million, if you look at the total described, this one maybe about 1 million, that what we have some information, some data. And if you look at the ratio of these insects among animals, you know, insects are also animals, but among other animals, say insects form about 3/4 of total animal kingdom. Such an dominating creatures on this universe. And if you think that we want to completely destroy them and other things, it is absolutely not possible. And so they have their own way of dealing with the higher animals in this ecosystem. Out of 1 million, about 10,000 are supposed to be pests. So as I said, probably they are damaging our crops, our furnitures, or maybe our farm animals, or sometimes to us, maybe like maybe assassin bug or sting bugs or something like that. Out of 10,000, 1,000 are serious pests. So including human-centric situations, so in the whole of universe, 1,000 type of insects are pests. Maybe and serious pests. So if you ask me, so look at those 1,000 number types where you have to think of managing systems. So you have to think of ideas how to manage them. That is very, very important when it comes to insect pests. So that way, now you decide whether you can survive without insects. So only 1,000 are pests. What about remaining 99.999% of insects? They are harmless. They are scavengers. They are beneficial insects. They are predators. They are pollinators. So many. They have a very big role. So now, as humans sitting on the top, can we live without insects? So that on that basis, let us build on the topic here today, especially urban foodscapes. We love this aspect. We love this process. But at the same time, should we consider insects as damaging pests in our garden? So that we have to look at it. See, the people have estimated, if insects vanish from this earth, humans and other life systems cease to exist in 3-4 years time. And if humans go, the earth will flourish. So let me not explain there. All of you can understand, but that is the reality today. What we look at it. So coming to anyway, that on 1,000 types of insects, which are pests, which are harmful, which are damaging. So economically important insects. As pests, let us say. So they can cross crop to loss to crops, to goods, or to our property. That's what I said. See, maybe termites, many times in our foundations and other things, they come in huge numbers. You have to look at that. How can we manage them? We want to keep our house. We want to protect our property. Agreed. No problem. So if you learn the basics of these insects, it is easily possible to manage them. It is not difficult. So some of them can cause physical injury, like bee stings or bug piercing, assassin bug especially. And of course, the forest like Amazon or even African forests, there are some insects, some spiders. So they can, spiders are not insects, but arthropods, the bigger class. So that way, or sometimes even lice, the head lice, maybe on our animals. So all wherever it is there, that they are sometimes, yes, they can cause some physical injury and there could be some kind of allergies. So we will see that one probably not beyond, not today's topic, beyond today's topic, but yes, they can cause, some of these insects cause damage. And some of them can bring in medical complications like the mosquito, the horseflies. Some of these, even people say even cockroach can bring in some of these diseases. That way, see, either directly or indirectly, there are some insects which are harmful to humans. So that way, see, direct or indirect damage, as I said, so they can feed on plant parts for their survival, maybe on fruiting bodies like fruit, flower, bud, or vegetative parts, probably as urban foodscapes. I'm showing you some of these examples, some of these pictures. Fruit, flower, and bud, and leaf, shoot, stem, bark, root, or underground parts. So in all these parts, insects have to survive. They feed on them to survive. They probably do not know that by this way that I am harming or I am probably pulling somebody's foot. That only humans can think of it. So they are trying to survive on this. And of course, Dr. Vishwanath always used to tell, whatever you do, you can harvest maximum 15% is the rent that what you are paying to the insects, because this land belongs to them, not to you. So that 15% rent, somehow, if you are not giving, the insects know how to get that rent. So they may not be fighting with you, but they know how to get that rent. So that's what they are doing. So that way, of course, so direct and indirect damage to human interests. So direct damage may be sucking pests damaged by sap feeding, or biting insects damaged by chewing. These are two major categories that we need to look at as urban foodscapists. So that's what we are trying to understand. So sucking pests are the ones which have maybe a piercing type of mouth parts. So they push their mouth parts into the plant parts and suck the juice. So they will not make the maybe bigger damage like on the leaf or leaf cuttings or the fruit boring, stem boring. These kind of things are not there. We will see what are those sucking pests. And at the same time, there are some biting insects which have very, very strong mandibles, their teeth, very strong. So they can make holes, they can tear into the leaf or the fruit. So they can chew on the plant parts and damage. So this way, basically, there are two types of insects that we encounter in our gardens, the sucking pests and the biting insects. So that way, I am not trying to take probably science into this. Very, very, that's what, because of this only I asked my junior, so that it is a kind of economic topic. And university professor gets in, probably he would have put more of economic issues here. I am an applied entomologist, a practical entomologist, being in urban foodscapes for 15, 16 years. So my way of looking at it is only practical aspects. If you ask me the scientific name, suddenly I may not be knowing. I may have to ask somebody, or I have to go back and refer my book. I know where it is available, but so that way. So we are not basic entomologists, we are applied entomologists. So that way, let us slowly move towards the topic in a limited time. Let us start with sucking pests. And this insect, I think this picture I am using from last 15 years. So the terrace garden, from our own terrace garden. So when we started doing these experiments and other things, so we did various studies and other things. So we were also not knowing, not about the insects, but which are all the insects, so what is the pattern. So during which time of the day or year that they are active. So we studied this very seriously in the initial years of our urban foodscapes with Dr. Vishwanath. So that way, so mealybugs, many of you have seen the white insect. So which will be in large numbers. So if you closely observe, that you can make out that they are the crawlers like ants. So on all your pots, at the growing medium, they'll be crawling and going up, looking for some space to settle down. What you need to understand is that here if there is one female, that is more than sufficient. They can multiply parthenogenetically. There is the sexual reproduction is not required in this kind of insects. Whenever they get an opportunity, you may think that I have removed 99 of the insects from the plant, so only one somehow left. Many times that it is a female. So otherwise the males are always winged. The mealybugs, the females are wingless. So they are crawlers. They search for the space. They go there, settle down, develop their colony if it is convenient for them. If it is not convenient, they probably be there and transform, attract the males and multiply by sexually and continue the progeny. It is always there. But if it is very convenient for them, they multiply parthenogenetically, produce asexual reproduction, produce huge numbers on a weak host. So they can produce large numbers and all along the stem. See, like this on hibiscus, the most liked probably garden plant for the mealybugs. So they can be in huge numbers and they can just go and cover all the growing tips. maybe on the leaves, on the flower buds, or even sometimes even on the flowers. So if the flower bud is affected, probably the it will not open properly. One or two petals may open. So that way, the mealybugs are one of the serious insects in our urban gardens. Vegetables, yes, little less, but they can be in huge numbers. Very quickly, as I said, as there is a parthenogenetic reproduction, so they can be in huge numbers. Just see this kind of the infestation in the farmer's field, just for the information. You would not have seen this, but very, very severe problem in the farmer's field. Farmers are struggling to manage mealybugs on papaya, very severe, on grapes. So all we love to eat grapes, but just think, grape is highly, highly pesticide prone. The residue level in grapes is very high to manage mealybugs. It is the grape bunches are dipped in insecticide solutions to manage them. Not easy. So that way, grape is one among the food crops having very highest residues of pesticides. So we know all these things, but what to do? It is their livelihood. So they have to manage somehow. So that way, very, very severe. I'm not getting into the management today. So they are very, very severe on perennial plants. In our houses, probably hibiscus is perennial, roses perennial, money plant perennial, something like this. Of course, it will come on marigold. Marigolds are probably, we will use marigold as a trap crop. So because of this reason. So yes, many times that we make the crop very weak. So we are not giving balanced fertilizer. We are not making the plant very tolerant. So sometimes that we use only cocopeat or only high nitrogenous compost in our growing medium, your plants become susceptible. So on a weak plant, on a susceptible plant, all insects, whatever I'm going to explain, all insects will take upper hand. So make the plants stronger, make the plants robust. That has to be the principle when it comes to management. So like that, aphids, as I said, the mealybugs, the aphids are also, they can multiply asexually whenever they get an opportunity in huge numbers. So generally on the lower side of the leaves or all along the stem, all along the fruit, probably they prefer the beans, the cowpeas, or the snake beans, or of course radish, others as well. See, you will see them on roses, you will see them on hibiscus, you will see them many types of crops, even lemon, chili, you will see them. I'm not telling that multiple colors, wingless. So they, once they come there, so they colonize. On provided that the situation is good. Just imagine that one day that you have seen one aphid today and immediately that you removed, done. So regular observation makes sense. And of course, now based on your experience, now you have started growing field beans, you have started growing hibiscus, and you have seen the aphid infestation last time, and you have tried your best, maybe spraying any water extracts, or any other home remedies. So you have struggled to manage them. So next time be observative. So keep observing. See, you know them that they are going to come. So that is very important. They can be very, very severe on your plants, like white flies. So different types. I'm not getting into the species. That is not the purpose today. So commonly that they are very severe, especially in the protected cultivations, in greenhouses, in polyhouses. Just imagine now, if the greenhouses and polyhouses, if these insects are there, what may be the size? So they can go with compost, they can go with soil, so unnoticed. So that is the size of, but even then, yes, they are more active. They can fly, they are winged insects. You can just, by turning the hibiscus leaf or turning this one, you can just make out the circular pattern of laying eggs. So yes, you have to identify that they are all the sucking pests. which can suck the juice. Let me come to some of these damages. The scale insects. All along the stem that you see some bubble-like structures all along the stem, especially when it is a neglected plant. If you are not observing, if you are not regular in your garden, so you can surely make out on the leaves, on the stem. Just see somebody. I should thank all my group members, maybe online, offline. So they will be sending these pictures and asking solutions. So that is the library for me, and probably some of these online sources that probably at up front that I have to thank all of them. So who have provided this kind of pictures for the presentation to convince people that the severity of certain insects, not all, certain insects, scale insects on curry leaf. See, if you ask me that, I will not allow so many curry leaf leaves on the plant, especially in the urban foodscapes. Curry leaf is not an ornamental plant. Curry leaf is a kind of vegetable, maybe aromatic, let us say. You should use it. You should not allow it to grow like this. You should use it. If you are not in a position to use it, probably cut and give it to your friends and relatives, neighbors, so that new leaves may not be having this kind of infestation. As the plants grow, that as the plants become older, it loses its the tolerance, the resistance. It's a wild plant in forests that they know how to manage them. So if it comes, okay, it will, all the leaves will fall off and new leaves will come. But in our this one that we have grown one or two plants, and we start seeing this kind of infestation, and we start searching for the solutions. The best solution is to keep using the leaves. New leaves will not be having this problem. Or keep pruning the plant. It's a wild plant. See, new shoots will not be having. Probably that we will discuss as we move on, probably the next session, not today. The mango, see this other, this one. Somebody has posted this on one of our groups. Maybe they may be watching the session as well. Neglected plant. Not even once that it is sprayed. Because mango, we are not using. No, mango, when it comes to flower and fruit, we start complaining that it is not flowering properly, fruits are not set. So that time, 10 months of the year that we are not worried about mango, then don't plant it. So if you have planted, if you think that it is a crop for you, if it is forest, don't worry, leave it. If you think that it is a crop, then you should take care of it. Otherwise, it is not a crop. It may be a forest plant. Leave it, no problem. So that way, many times that, see, on a lighter side that I am telling, that we also suggest that you spray forceful water, that it will manage. So we say that you spray rice water, it will manage. We know as an entomologist, they are not solutions. We know that it is not possible to manage this kind of infestation. If there are one or two insects are there, that you can do it. So that way, I am trying to put those insects which are so serious, and you have to take up one or the other management options. And you all know, many of you know, many, I have at least so many questions in my WhatsApp and probably on Facebook page, maybe Bricks Garden Book page, wherever so people ask, because they can make out. So many ants. Today morning also, I was there for a session for an Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangha. So there ants on my plants, there are too many ants. So what should I do? I asked, sir, whether it is terrace garden, kitchen garden. No, terrace garden, but ants are too many on there. Then I said, you go and check, sir. Ants are not pests. Ants are nuisance. So they may not be probably just you go there, it will not come and bite you. It is not possible. So these insects, another very, very important symptom of presence of sucking pests like mealybugs, aphids, scales, white flies. So because they suck the juice in excess, more than their requirement, and secrete that juice as honeydew or honey drop. So on that, these ants by nature, they love sugar. They will visit your plants. They develop their colonies because sugar is plenty. And let me just go and have a colony in the near that container or near that garden. So let me have a nest. So immediately, probably they will have one more house in that area and develop their colony. Ants simply, if your plant is protected nicely and with a regular spray and other things that we'll discuss, but if there are no sucking pests, so ants cannot come there to feed on the leaves, on the fruit or some, not possible. It is not their nature. Sometimes, of course, if it is a very sweet sapota fruit or something like that, some insects may come and ants may come and puncture and probably try to take some sugar. That is fine because it is sugar. Otherwise, generally they cannot eat on anything vegetative part. 99% of the ants, 1 or 2% types, maybe species may be there. That way, so you will see the presence of ants whenever there is sucking pest damage. Please, please, if there are ants, just turn the leaf, see the shoots, growing tips, look for sucking pests damage like mealybugs, aphids, scales, white flies. And see one picture that I put it here, again, online picture. See, these ants help the sucking pest to survive. They are fighting their enemy, the mealybug, the ladybug. So the ladybirds are the predators on all these sucking pests. But these ants are going and fighting with that ladybird because they know that if the sucking pests are there, I can get maximum of sugar. And if they are killed, if they are managed with this kind of ladybirds, then I will not get my sugar. See, this kind of observation that you can make out in your small spaces. Another important observation from the sucking pests, particularly these spores that what I suggested, many more, of course, hoppers and others, they are not that serious. I did not take those examples here. My experience of 15 years that I tried to put some of these, of course, general. Your leaves, your fruits, they are all having maybe black coloration, the sooty mouth development. Whenever there is the sugar secretion, so on the leaves, sugar is liked by fungus as well, the sooty mouth. So it will come and develop on maybe on lemon, on sitapal, ramphal, mangoes, sapota. Wherever that infestation is there, your leaves, your fruits on the lower side, generally. So it will become black. And we start complaining. Of course, indirectly, yes, this kind of black color can cause maybe reduce the photosynthesis and further growth, further yield. All these things are fine. But for me, if you ask that, it is minor. It can be, if you manage the insect, this will not be there. These are all manifestations. These are not the cause. The cause is something different. So that way, so sucking pests, whenever there is sucking pest damage, you will see the presence of ants. You will see the black color on the leaves on the lower side. Then other type of sucking pests like thrips. See, many of you have seen the upward curling of chili leaves, upward curling in your hibiscus or maybe roses, sometimes even in jasmine. Sorry. So there it is because of the presence or the feeding of thrips. Again, the small insects. Probably to see the thrips, you may have to use sometimes the hand lens. Closely, if you observe that, you can make out. But the plant, based on the plant symptoms that you can make out, plants cannot talk. They are trying to tell you that there is some problem with particular insect. So if you want me to perform, think of it. So that's what it is trying to tell you with all these kind of symptoms. So thrips, sometimes especially in chili, even mites, and sometimes even the viruses. You can, as a scientist, that you can make out this is the thrips damage, this is the mite damage, this is the virus infestation. But for me, we are laymen. So we are just trying to see that there is some leaf curl in our gardens. So what may be the reason? there could be thrips, there could be mites, there could be virus. Let us see. Leaf curl is a big problem, but insect manifested. And of course, there are the onion, for example. In the farmer's field, it's a very, very severe pest, onion thrips. You can make out from a distance that you can make out that this particular field, particular plant is having thrips problem because of that patch, the specks. Very, very, very shiny, silvery specks. You can just make out on the onion leaves. So that way, that you have to see whether this is there in our garden or something. So that's what I just put it the session particularly only on insect incidents, its symptoms, and probably the damage. So if you understand the basics of these things, much easier for us to see how to manage them, whether they are serious, whether they are not serious, whether they are okay, whether they are not okay. So that decision that we mites. If you ask me specifically during summer, one insect or one, maybe one arthropod, mites are not insects, but one arthropod or one problem, one pest, which is very severe in urban gardens is our mites, the spider mites. So they can just cover the whole of your plant with the webs, particularly in summer. During rainy season, they are not pests. Rainy season is for the fungus or the pathogens. Summer is for the insect pests. So that way you will make out some of these pictures that I put it. So if you just see on the upper side, if you just see that, you will see small specks or the white spots, irregular spots, and just turn it, you can see the presence of brown insects, or many times even the webs on the plants possible. So this, anyway, many of you have seen. I also taken this picture from the group only. The chili mites problem. So growth retardation completely gone. This further, there is no growth. See, elongated petiole. Very abnormal. That is the infestation of chili mites. This kind of what is that? Masses. Thick masses, thick leaves. The problem of mites. So you have to, maybe you may have to differentiate a little bit whether the damage is because of thrips, whether the damage is because of mites. There's fine variation in the management strategy. For us as urbanites, we may not be differentiating that way. But in the farmer's field, yes. So if it is a thrips damage, there is a different strategy. If it's a mites damage, it's a different strategy. So that way, if you can make out in the early stage that there is mites damage in my crop, it is much easier for us to manage nicely. Then pod bugs, many of you have seen. These pictures are all from the group expression, some of them may be online or based on my the queries and questions. If the pictures, sometimes they are, if they are not sharp, I would have taken from the online sources, online resources. The pod bugs on the beans, mostly pulses. They are the pests of pulses. Your red gram, your cowpea, or your green gram, black gram. So wherever there is beans, so they are the serious pests. Pod bugs, farmers feed, very, very severe pest. In our case, that it is a pest on ivy gourd. So many of you have seen ivy gourd because it is a perennial crop. Sometimes that we neglect it because it is growing. Let us not spray on that. Then that is a nice place for them to survive. Whenever you are thinking of protecting ivy gourd, then from this pest, then think of it. Otherwise, leave it. It's okay. No problem. So that way, then there are shield bugs or the stink bugs. Many of you have seen, especially the youngster, the nymphs, the egg masses. Many times, if you, probably they are laid in groups. So if you just turn it, you make out the so scouting is very important. So you can make out whether they are the eggs from the eggs of the pests or eggs of predators. So anyway, you cannot make out the eggs of parasitoids because they are laid inside the host. Generally, the pests are predators. So you have to keep seeing, probably not to become scientist. I am not trying to tell that at all. But at the same time, the minimum basic idea of whether this is a pest insect or this one. See, some of one picture that I got, I think, on the group. So the so many numbers that you will make out all along the stem, at least whether it is beneficial or whether it is a pest insect, you can just make out. If you want to leave it, no problem. But otherwise, if you think that no, my for me, my plants are very important, plant health is very important, I am not worried about animals, I am not a conservationist, I am not an ecologist, I am an entomologist, I am an agricultural entomologist. So if you look at it in that angle, or I am a farmer. So though I am in Bangalore, I want to see myself as a farmer. I want to harvest the maximum from my garden. So if you look at it, then they are all pests. So that way that you have to see, you have to think of managing these insects as well. See this, the picture set, not very common, but in some gardens, the sheet bugs or the stink bugs, these are all petasphid bugs, what we call that, the same order, Homoptera. So they come in huge numbers, and surely they can suck the juice and make the plants weak. So that way, so and to take a picture, very nice pictures, very photogenic. So you probably just by sending to somebody, and why you want to kill them, they may ask, because they don't know, they are just seeing their pictures, they don't know the seriousness of the insect. So if you are okay with it, you should surely. Then what happens with sucking pests? Another thing. So many of these sucking pests are the vectors of plant viruses. So when you think that there is only one whitefly is there, only one aphid is there, so let me not take up, let me just spray forcefully with water. They may, that particular insect may be the vector of a plant virus. It can cause leaf curl. It can cause mosaic. So you don't know that one is sufficient to transfer the virus. Luckily that in corona time, corona is not vector borne. Otherwise, the places like Bangalore or any other city with so much of mosquito and other things, know that by this time it would have spread 50% of the population. So just imagine that, probably relate. So the potential of the vectors. So sucking pests, the aphids, the thrips, the even sometimes mites, whiteflies, they are the vectors. They can just a little bit fly out. Or maybe just imagine that whenever an aphid is feeding on an infected, a virus-infected plant, and from there that it has come to the healthy plant. It cannot thrive, ants will help them. So ants bring from there to the other plant on their antennae. That is the mutualistic, this one, that means I did not go there. But anyway, so very, very severe vectors, sucking pests, another big, serious, challenging problem is vector. See cucumber mosaic. We always say, sir, this was growing so nicely, suddenly that there is some mosaic symptoms. The yellow and green colored spots on the leaves. The low or the lower leaves are healthy, only the upper leaves or the younger leaves are having these kind of symptoms. Virus suddenly that it sucking pest infestation happened, and virus transferred. Of course, virus can be seed borne also, but first time it can be seed borne. Once it comes to the plant in the feed, that it can spread only by insects. Virus cannot just go and fly. It is not possible. Some kind of infecting material has to go from this plant. Maybe if you have just cut with a scissor this plant and you have cut the other plant, that quick. The transfer of the nucleic material is still possible. But otherwise, many times plant viruses are vector borne, and these vectors are the sucking pests. In our urban foodscapes also, these sucking pests are serious, serious vectors. many times that we see, sir, all my chili plants are looking healthy, and what should I take? I always say they are healthy, but still take up some protections, some precautions, because there can be one insect which you have not noticed, which has gone unnoticed, probably maybe the vector, and it can cause the leaf curl in the days to come. Keep spraying. So that's what is required. Bunchy top is an very, very severe problem in farmers' field. In our case also, somehow that we have started or brought one banana, and suddenly it started having this kind of symptoms. After seeing the symptom, you can't do anything. So you have to protect banana, because this that you wanted to grow. Of course, only leaves can be used. So if your expectation is only maybe using the leaves to make some maybe rotis, akki rotis, ragi rotis, no problem. Now you can still use it, so nothing happens. But otherwise, if you are expecting the bunch from this, it is not possible. So aphids are the very, very severe the vectors of the banana bunchy top. So we will not be knowing. I because of that only somebody has sent this picture. So that the on our terrace garden we had one or two banana plants, and suddenly that there is some problem in banana is not growing, stunted. So that way, see, all these things can happen. Papaya, many of us that we have this problem. It was a very nice papaya from last 1 year. The first crop was so good, and suddenly my papaya leaves are yellowing, discolored. So like that, see, papaya mosaic, papaya ring spot, they are the viruses, plant viruses transmitted by the white flies, the aphids, and your crop is gone. You cannot make them to recover. If somebody says that I can make your plant recover at this stage, once you see the virus manifestation that much, surely not possible. So you will be spending your energy there, especially having one or two plants, and if you think that I want to recover the plant, it's not possible. So that way, plant protection is very important. So let me quickly capture that whatever I said. So the sucking pests, they can multiply very fast on a weak host because of parthenogenetic reproduction. They will be looking for an opportunity. Very prevalent in summer and summer-like conditions. See, you may think that no, it is not summer, sir, rainy season. But somehow rain did not happen, and you would not have watered properly. The outside temperature and other things are very high, very, very good for the insects to multiply. Then it can maybe dry conditions making the plants weaker, so they can, and during that time their life cycle, if they are taking about 1 month, 4 5 weeks to complete one life cycle during summer, they it will be 30-40% less time. So very fast life cycles, I said, they infest in huge numbers. And that way, when it comes to one or two, nothing happens. Of course, as vectors, yes, they are serious, but otherwise, probably they are not that yield reducing factors. But in huge numbers, yes, surely they can manifest and cause the problems. They prefer the growing tips because they are succulent or susceptible. Maybe whenever you are putting the more of nitrogen and other things, then leaves, fruit stalks, fruit surfaces, stem portions may not kill the plant but make the plant unviable. Then curling and twisting of leaves, wilting of young seedlings and shoot tips, discoloration of or the leaves and other things, whatever I said, bulged or swollen leaves or stems, stunting, growth retardation I showed in case of chili mites, reduced vigor, weak plants, and dropping of flower buds and deformed flowers and distorted flowers, malformed fruits, increased ant activity, sooty mold on the leaves, and viral infections. So this way, the sucking pests as a group are very, very serious, and you have to look. And if you ask me whether the sucking pests are serious or the biting insects are serious on urban foodscapes, it is sucking pest. You have to target or your strategies to manage sucking pests. In the process, your biting insects are also managed. So sucking pests are very, very serious. So let me quickly move. So the time is just going. The biting insects, as I said, they have the very strong mandibles. They can have different type of damage on the plant parts. The cutworms, they can cut the seedlings, cut the plants at the collar region, cut the shoots. Not, of course, once it's, why I said seedling is that as the plants grow, they are not pests. They will be in the soil, dwelling in the soil. So probably not very common in urban foodscapes, but in the farmer's field, yes. But sometimes the one female moth would have come here and laid its eggs in the soil. It emerges, the caterpillar emerges, and it can surely cut. Many of our friends have sent these pictures. So we will be seeing the cutworms as well. It can cut very serious. So once it is cut, the plant is gone. So there is no question of recovery at all. So that way that you need to look at that, how can we manage? The leaf feeders, especially the leaf feeders, Podoptera, what we say, leaf-eating caterpillars. So the radish or mustard soft fly. On radish, it was growing so nicely overnight that you can see the huge numbers and defoliating on the leaves. The tussock moth larvae. So they are the very serious defoliators and they can be in huge numbers. The spingeet, the hawk moth. Many of us, Plusia, all these pictures that what I have put, they are very, very serious defoliators and they can just devour on the leaves and they can be in huge numbers as well, especially the caterpillars. In the initial stage that they will be in congregation, if you can make out during that time, that is very, and they will be there on different type of insects, different type of crops. So in your garden, you will see them. You will surely see them. And many of you have seen this. The lime butterfly, on the caterpillars, on your lime, on your curry leaf, on your maybe citrus, many weeds, it will be there. See, it is basically on weeds, especially for us in Bangalore, that we are on butterfly corridor. We see them. See, the only issue is that how you see it. See, many times that I have seen in the groups and other things, so if somebody puts, it is all eating my curry leaf leaves. Many of us members, many times including me, generally I don't do because I know that it is serious. But people say, don't do anything, let it become butterfly. So in the process of butterfly, it will damage your crop. So which is important for you? That decision that you have to take. For you, if you want to see this kind of butterfly, yes, look at it. Don't worry. Yours is a food forest. Yours is an urban biodiversity garden. Fine, no problem, no issue. Define that. So, but if yours is urban biodiversity, or if you want to protect, if you want to see somebody others, who are you to take, conclude for them? For them, it may be a serious pest. So they would have taken or spent all their energy to grow a curry leaf plant and they wanted to use it. So you cannot just guide like that. So that way, so if you ask me as an entomologist, as an agriculture entomologist, as a horticulture entomologist, they can devour the whole of lime plant, whole of curry leaf plant. So that way that it is a pest. But if you see as the butterfly, probably we all enjoy. We don't want to go and harvest that particular plant. We don't know where it is there. We always say that butterflies have to be conserved, butterflies have to be conserved, butterflies have to be conserved. Agree. Just imagine instead of butterfly conservation, somebody, a farmer's livelihood is growing. Whether you want to tell that. So that way, look at it. See how you put yourself that you look at it. See the monarch butterflies. So beautiful. In our farm that if you go there during that time of the year, you will see so many the butterflies on the tree species. We all enjoy. But that particular plant, imagine that particular plant, the stress that particular curry leaf plant undergoing by providing food to a lime butterfly. You cannot just imagine. So as in probably a learned person, that you may have to look at that, how can I protect my plant? How can I make the plant stress free? So that decision that you have to take. The cabbage butterfly, cabbage white. Beautiful. See, whenever we are students in agriculture university, we used to go in the farm to collect. This was an activity for us. So beautiful butterfly. And when you see the butterfly, probably you don't want to kill it. But when you go and see the crop, cabbage crop, a serious pest. So you need to see that, how can you manage. The diamond back moth, leaf scrapers, very severe pest. See, the cabbage, cauliflower, we all complain that cabbage and cauliflower is sprayed. It is not very good. It is highly the toxic, and it is sprayed on a regular basis to manage this particular insect, the diamond back moth, in our gardens as well. See, many of us are growing cabbage, many of us are growing cauliflower, and it is still growing, sir. The head is not coming. When it will, the head is already damaged. You are not observing, you are just seeing the leaves. Leaves are growing nicely. Leaves will grow. Leaves is not the one that what we are looking at. We are looking at the head. Head will come in the growing tip. If that growing tip is damaged, leaves will be still growing. So you need to observe that. See, as diamond back moth, as leaf scrapers, very serious. Beetles, Epilacna beetles, or maybe some other type of beetles. They make the, on the leaves, a netted surface. So much of the damage that they make, they scrape both adults as well as the grubs. So they can damage and make your leaves netted. The grasshoppers, the weevils, ash weevils. So they are also leaf feeders. They also defoliate. But you can just make out from the edges that they are making some holes. Irregular holes may not be regular all the time. Caterpillars generally make the regular holes. These grasshoppers and weevils, they make irregular holes. They feed from the sides. They have to just scrape. So that way, from the margins and other things, that you have to think that there is some grasshopper damage. Grasshopper generally, it won't come. Probably your garden is not clean. Nearby there is some weed or the forest area. So from there that they can come. Suddenly it cannot just come and see here, if I go, I will get my food. No. So it will be probably coming from a weed, weedy or the maybe unattended the sites or unattended areas, unattended fields. So weevils and grasshoppers are also problems. So they can defoliate. Just imagine that they are defoliators. Then some, maybe especially sweet potato. Many of us have started growing sweet potato. And many times that's sweet potato weevil, or the tortoise beetles, or the pumpkin beetles. So they can also make some holes and resulting in damage. Finally, see, when the leaf is not there, but just understand that all the plants have ability to sustain 30 to 35% of the leaf damage. If one or two leaves are cut, or one or two holes are there in the leaves, nothing happens. So that way, they are also feeding on the leaves, defoliators. Then the leaf miners, they will be feeding between the two layers of the leaves, maybe on our tomato, or maybe citrus leaf miners, serious problem. We also say, nothing happens, sir, don't worry. But just imagine, there are only two leaves. And if the two leaves are having this leaf miner problem, then there is no question of coming third leaf, the plant will die. We it is easy to say. Honestly, we have to see what is the age of the plant. So it is quite big, sir, one or two leaves are, don't worry, sir, leave it. If it is still seedling, and if the leaf miner is there, it can kill. So that way, we whenever we are suggesting, so we have to see the background, why, for what purpose that it is being grown, and what is the expectation. All these things, of course, as urbanites, if you can manage, or you can probably afford to lose one crop, one plant, it is fine, no problem. But so you have to see, at least for me today, as agricultural entomologist, I am not even entomologist today, I am not an ecologist today, I am simply an academic agriculture entomologist. I am trying to bring in all those information or all those insects which can cause damage in your plants. So that way, that these leaf miners are also very severe, they can cause damage. Leaf cutter bee, not serious for me, but sometimes, yes, somebody has sent this picture on the group. So I am seeing this kind of damage. No problem, no issues. It is not, no one is perfect, we don't know. But basically, this kind of cuts are because of the leaf cutter bees, or sometimes leaf cutter ants. So even not to feed, they are taking this kind of round discs to make the nests. So making nests, they need this kind of probably the leaf material. So they are taking, they are cutting. And if you closely observe, all this activity is an interesting activity. You can capture in videos and probably share with people. But just imagine that this damage is not for survival. This damage is for making their nests. Now, not as food material, so like that. So this kind of gall weevils. So I'm also not very sure whether should I put it in the sucking pests or the biting insects, whatever may be the case. But you have seen on mango, on ivy gourd, or many other plants, that there is a bulged portion on the leaves, bulged portion on the stem. So very severe, the insects, both adults as well as nymphs, they will be inside. They have made their nest inside, and from there that they are feeding on and manifesting as galls, leaf galls. We call it as aphid galls, or sometimes on grapes, on mango, they are very severe. They have to be managed and integrated manner. So that is always there. Then these kind of fruit borers, stem borers, shoot borers. So they are also very, very, very see, especially on brinjal. In Indian situation, you have to probably look at that. These are very severe. See, brinjal, if you ask me, it is sprayed every other day, every third day. And in Indian situation, it is one of the vegetable with lots and lots of residues to manage. Just imagine that it is a serious pest, and in our urban foodscapes also that it's a serious problem. The leaf webbers, the chopper beetles, the blister beetles, they're the flower feeders, the biting insects, but they feed on the flowers. They can feed on the pollen. They can feed on the seeds. So that way also that they can damage, or maybe say blister beetles, in the farmer's field, on pigeon pea, it is a serious pest. On us, probably on our bendy, maybe sometimes on roses, hibiscus. So they will be feeding, and they are serious pests sometimes. Chopper beetles, many of us have seen. But just by seeing the green color or the red color, shiny color, that we just want to go and see, take a picture. But it is a pest and a serious pest. Fruit flies. So fruit flies, probably many of us as the urban gardeners growing ridge gourd, bitter gourds, bottle gourds, or sometimes even guava, sapota, so very severe. And the adults just go and make a puncture and lay eggs, and you will not make out at that moment. So when the fruit is young, so the maggots start feeding from inside, and there will be, the fruits are bent. And as the fruit will be just growing like that, and once you cut it, that inside the hole is decayed material, or it may not grow sometimes. And if it is growing, it is a bent fruit, or the whole fruit is gone. It will not, see, it is not a pest on maybe on your leaf or the stem or something. It is a fruit on pest on the fruit. So your plant will be growing nicely. You always say plants are growing nicely, sir. The fruit is now having some problem. The fruit fly is a very, very severe problem in our urban foodscapes. And the fruit borer or the budworms, severe pest, in the farmer's field, cotton borer, see pigeon pea pod borer, red the Bengal gram pod borer, very severe pest, more than 200 hosts. Vegetables, many vegetables, all the peas, beans, everything is damaged. Luckily for us, it is not that severe. I just put it because that it will come. We have seen this insect in urban gardens, and it will be just feeding on the flowers, feeding on the fruits, and all the insects which are feeding on the flowers, feeding on the fruits are serious problems. If there are some, as I showed some of these defoliators, leaf eating, if one or two cuts are there, not a problem. Not that just as a biting insect, as example, many of us are not growing mango, but otherwise mango stone weevil, which can be the insect on the stone. So it will be the, just imagine the wisdom of the mother. So the eggs are laid at the time of flowering. So the larvae or the adult gets into the ovary and gets into the stone. So the outside pulp at that moment, it is absolutely not damaged. You will get a normal fruit. But once you cut it, if it is also very severe, so sometimes there could be some damage coming out from the stone. Otherwise, even the stone is also fine. You will be seeing, you will be eating your mango. But that stone, for what purpose that it is then probably to produce the next generation from the mango, that cannot happen. So that way, you see minor insect, just for your information. Bark feeders, again, not that this one, we are not growing that kind of perennial plants, but on mango, on coffee, on many of these things, that there are some insects, the biting insects, which are feeding, and sometimes it can make the plants weak, the upper portion, it can break because of the wind and other things. We will see. I don't have any idea at this moment whether they can be so serious in our urban foodscapes. But some of this that people have sent, not manual, urban foodscape, when I say that it is not just the container gardening, it is kitchen gardening, particularly on lemon, citrus. So we have this kind of problem, very severe problems, particularly this last 2-3 years, that it is becoming very serious, what my friends say. So stem borers have become very serious. So the eggs are laid, the grubs get into the stem, and it will be feeding from inside, generally moving downwards. See, as the size of the grub grows, that it has to grow downwards. It cannot go upwards. And you can make this kind of symptom, the powdery stuff coming from the holes and near the plant, that you can just make out all this powdery. And if you just cut open and see, you can make out the grubs. So that way, the stem feeders or the stem borers in coffee stem borer, severe problem. Mango stem borer, severe problem. Cashew stem borer, severe problem. But in our case, most probably the lemon stem borer or the citrus stem borer is a severe problem. The sweet potato weevil underground. Okay. Many of us are growing sweet potatoes today, and suddenly all our the tubers get damaged. So adults, as well as the grubs, the young ones, so they will bore into the tuber, they will bore into the roots and affect the plant. So there can be yellowing, there can be, so if you just cut open, that your tuber is not good, there will be tunnels, because that the grubs have fed in that this one. So on you probably, you sometimes that you see that somehow I am watering, I am putting compost and other things, the plant is still growing. The I don't know what happened to the tubers. Tubers are having problems. The adults, the weevils are the serious problem. And the root grubs, very recently, for me, see, as an agriculture entomologist, as a field or the integrated pest management specialist, for me, it is not that serious in the farm, in the container gardening. But many of my friends, I have seen, sir, I have root grubs problem, particularly in the onset of monsoon. So suddenly it can come. It can infest, and people who are bringing the compost and soil from the rural areas, sometime that time also, that you will see the root grubs. They feed on the, by nature, see, they are underground, they have to feed on the roots. They will not come and feed on your flowers or the fruits. That is not possible. That is not their purpose. Their survival itself is on the roots. So on the underground, when the root is damaged, when the new roots are not formed, the it has to be expressed in maybe yellowing, the death, the drying of leaves, the dropping of flowers, dropping of fruits. All these things can happen because of this. So that way, biting insect can be defoliators, which are feeding on the leaves. The biting insect can be stem borers, fruit borers, or the flower feeders. Biting insects can be on the underground parts. So I did not bring termites and other things because I know that they are not that serious in urban foodscapes. But this way, that there are two categories, what I said, the sucking pests and basic insects, the biting insects. But very, very important, big topic now on yeast, how to manage them. I am stopping today there. See, how to manage these insect pests in urban foodscapes, because this is entirely different than in the farmer's field. You cannot compare the management strategies that what you practice in the farmer's field and what you have to do or what you need to do in the urban gardening or urban foodscapes. So that way, for us as humans, we are just one out of 5,000 plus mammals in this universe, a small dotted line, and insects, highly dominant species, and quickly they can evolve and come out with solutions for all those the strategies that what we make. So that way, it is the management strategy in urban foodscapes has to be designed, devised very carefully. So depending upon the type of insect that what you will encounter in your garden. So that's what I have tried to make. Hope that it is of some use for all of you as viewers today. Those who have joined directly here, those who are there on YouTube, so many probably an interesting topic. So many have written, so many have responded to my WhatsApp message. Yes, we want to join. It is an interesting topic and other things. Fine. But what I have tried to do is that now we will see that how to manage. But now you decide. See, which are all the insects that what you are encountering and what you are looking for in the management strategy session next week. So that's where we will just look at it. So there I am stopping there. Thank you and keeping it open. Let me just close this presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajendra Hegde. Not sure if Dr. Rajesh is back online yet. Okay. There are many questions related to the management of the pests at this stage, and more than anything related to the pest itself. So I think some of those questions we'll probably take up during the subsequent sessions. There are questions related to how do we avoid snails and bugs and leeches in gardens, to topics like what are the organic solution to manage sucking and biting pests, so how to manage mealybugs, how do they maybe
all those probably Anil, all those management question this one. So as I said in the very beginning, a vast topic, and it is not possible to cover in one session. So I request all of you who have asked questions, we have solutions. We will discuss on all those issues, maybe the part two next session of this serial. You have to, and insect pests, and probably we will discuss on the plant pathogens also. I have requested one of my professor friends from the university to join on the 6th of December, the 13th of December. So we will discuss on all those issues. Next week, we will discuss only on management aspects. And I request all of you who have asked questions on YouTube, probably wait for next week, or probably keep your questions, or you can even send some of these questions so that I can prepare and answer on Bricks Garden book. That is the page that we have. If you just put it on Facebook, that Bricks Garden book that you will see, then you can post some of these questions with pictures and other things so that I can probably prepare. One question here, Premida, what she asked is that whether increasing temperature have you seen increasing insect infestation? Not really, Pramila. Insect increase in temperature is probably one reason for making the plants weak. That is the cause probably. And when once the plant become weak, the insects think that this particular plant is what is that? It is my place, so I can go and colonize, and I can develop my colonies there. So then automatically the population increases. It is not annual increase of temperature or something like that. During the hot months of the year, the insects enjoy. The higher the temperature, there is problem of insects. Higher the humidity, there will be problems of fungus and the pathogens.
Right, sir. Thank you for that. And maybe, you know, these are many questions related to obviously the management, which we, as you said, we will pick up during the next session. And we request all the participants and also all the viewers to have your questions listed and post it on our channel so that we can always be ready to answer those questions in the subsequent sessions. And with this, I would like to thank Dr. Rajendra Hegde for taking this session on short notice. And as always, you've been the foundation and the pillar for everything that we've been doing at Garden City Farmers. So thank you for that. And also to bring about a very simple perspective on a very, very complex topic such as this, where we have a very deep knowledge that is required to even scratch the surface. So you brought a lot of that perspective in a very, very simple manner. So thank you for that. With this, we would like to bring this session to a conclusion, and we request all our viewers to also popularize the channel, share this with your friends and family and your garden friends, to come and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Organic Terrace Gardening, and we will continue this series of gardening sessions in the coming weeks and months. So thank you so much. With this, I would like to close the session for now. Senthil, if you can end the on YouTube live streaming.
Live streaming.